someone here that does not speak Portuguese?
I would speak in English. First of all, good morning. Welcome to this workshop on creation. Creation is a National Science Foundation, Portuguese National Science Foundation, excellent project. It was awarded 3 years ago with a 5-year plan, and we are ending in 2 months the first 3 years of the project. So these first 3 years are very important for our project, because actually the National Science Foundation is going to evaluate our results and see if they will sponsor us 2 more extra years in this area. So most of you know the creation concept. The creation concept was to build very high efficiency or energy efficiency and very high bitrate digital wireless radio. And I think today you will see a large amount of outcomes from this project that actually prove that in a 3-year time frame we already achieved some of the goals that we were expecting for the 5-year program. But there are a lot of other things to do. And this is what we want that you all see today, and hopefully all see and have an idea of what can be done in the future of this area. So I would like also to acknowledge the table. So for the opening session, we have the Vice Rector of the University of Aveiro, which I thank you very much for coming. We have also Professor João Carlos Ferreira from Inesco Tech, from the University of Porto. Professor Vieira Vieta in the University of Aveiro. Myself, I'm representing IT, and in this case from the University of Aveiro. And we are missing one colleague that is stuck in the traffic, that comes from Beira Interior and is representing IT from Beira Interior. So the team of the project was composed exactly by these three main research institutions in Portugal, which is the Institute of Telecommunication, which was the prime contractor, let's say, of this project. Then we have Inesco-Tec, and we have also IETA. And of course, each of these research institutes are connected with universities, and the universities that are represented in the project is the University of Aveiro, University of Porto, and University of Beira Interior. So this gives a nice picture of what is the team, what we have been doing, and I think the day is going to be a great day. We also invite two invited speakers from abroad. We hope, and our main goal, let's say, with the talks from these very important speakers coming from University of Alcalá, University Alcalá in Spain, and University of Tampere in Finland, is that we actually learn from them, and that's our main goal in inviting them here, and also that they see what we have been doing, and they gave us some feedback, positive or negative, but they can give us some feedback for our work in our areas. The other, before I close my intervention, that I want to say is that I would like to acknowledge all the PhD students, most of the people that is in the room today, because to be honest, without the PhD students, this will not be possible. All these posters probably will be a single poster with a lot of text, but no results at all. So the PhD students are, and the master students also, many PhD students are the fundamental pieces of the project, and thank you very much to all of you that, as you can see, were able to put this together. So.
Okay, I would like to thank you all for coming to this final workshop. I hope this is not the final one. In 2 years we have the real one, but the final one. Hope that we enjoyed this this day, this workshop, that you learned from the posters and the demos that are here. And I would like to thank the Vice Rector to be here supporters, and that you can say that, a few words about it.
Wow.
Okay, thank you very much. In fact, after the words of Nuno, almost impossible to say something new or important, but at least congratulate you all to be here, especially those that came from the institutions that are part of this important project. So we wish you all the best, so have a nice day here in Aveiro, and a fruitful day especially. As Nuno said, the project is intended to be a five-year project, so you are in the end of the third year. I'm quite sure that you made a great job, and it's more than fair to find the finance to continue for the next two years. So this is my wish. So if I can do something in helping this direction, of course I will do. I don't know precisely the results, but as I said, I see lots of demonstrations, lots of posters, so it's clear that the project is successful. But you know, we are facing many difficulties in Portugal, especially concerning FCT. Things are changing all the time. And yesterday we learned that we have a new president for FCT, so there is a new team for FCT. So there are lots of documents circulating with new ideas, so many things will change for sure. And so let's see if these changes are positive or negative. I hope they will be positive, of course. But especially if they ask me some recommendation, I would say that we need stability in the system, because all the time changing. Ways of financing, the rules all the time changing, the no schedules. So for students, are certainly PhD students, you suffer because there is no calendar for opening the grants, etc., etc. So evaluation of the research committees. We are here, there are three research committees here represented, but that were evaluated by FCT, and we know all this process. That was a complex project process. People claim that in next year there will be a new evaluation. So be prepared for that. And what I have to tell you, be prepared for that, because everything indicates that next year there will be a completely new evaluation of the research committees. So I know that either IT were not well evaluated, so I think it's time to adjust procedures, and because it's not the question of the work you did, because I know it's excellent, there is no doubt about that, but there was something that failed. All the way how we present the meetings, or I don't know, because you know there was a part that is a part concerning to the past, so the results of the past. But there was another part that counts also 50%, that is the project for future. And maybe this project for future was the problem. I don't know. We should be careful with the process. Because in the past it was a kind of automatic. We are very good, we keep very good, we are excellent, we keep excellent. Nowadays things change, and so it's necessary to be careful with this process. I recommend be careful with presentations, with the documents we send, etc., to see if there will be this new evaluation, to see if we can improve our classification, because it means the funding, etc., and it's very important. Another problem we are facing now is with this regional financing, this competition of regional financing, national financing, state financing, etc. So there are different ideas, so money came to the region to be used in the region, but nowadays there are a tendency to somehow to change the rules in the projects, to put this money also administrated by the National Science Foundation, etc. So there are lots of constraints, so there are lots of rules changing, so we have to be careful, and because it's not, we are not sure what will happen. In my idea, maybe this is a mistake, Portugal is contributing. The fact we are trying to, especially FCT in the past, try to follow what happens with, for instance, Horizon 2020, or the idea of the regional funds that are focused more on research, no? So there is these lines of research, so more technological applied, relation with industry, etc. And somehow FCT tend to follow these rules. And this is, in my opinion, as far as I know, this is not what we see in the other countries. So there are other countries that have, they have national funds for basic and fundamental science. And on top of it, there are also these financing. Also 2020 with different objectives, etc., etc. And we need to have this basic, the basic science. And if FCT go have the same rules as Horizon 2020 or something like that, so I think we will face some problems. So it should be clear, money for fundamental science, money for things more related to industry, technological things. So there are different kinds of projects, but we have to have all the say, all scenario and not only focus on one area, in my opinion. Okay, but I will stop. I will stop here. Wish you a pleasant day, and especially showing what we do, you did of the relevant, to see if we can continue this project for more 2 years. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for words. And I think that we can continue with our workshop for the first presentation.
Okay, good morning everybody. So I'm from the trailer, and I'll be talking about the outcomes that were produced at NSTEC in the context of this project. And so these are the people who have worked here, Professor Michel da Silva, Maris Ferreira, Gavan, and Amin Barahami are working also in different in the project. You'll see one demo here from Gavan. I hope it will be working. Okay. So just a small introduction. We all know the challenges that are connected to wireless communication systems for the next generations. And in fact, the increasing number of protocols and the better utilization of the spectrum have been major issues. And one way to address that is to have reconfigurable hardware or reconfigurable systems, reconfigurable radios, not just at the software level, but also at the hardware level. in addition, so I'm basically focusing on the parts where NS Tech worked here. And so when it had to do with baseband processing and having a configurable baseband processing, and the other one is to have efficient, power efficient power amplification that is efficient over a very wide range of frequencies. And in that context, Inesh developed a Class J power amplifier based on the gallium nitride high mobility transistor, high electromobility transistors, and the idea being to cover a wide range of frequencies to cater for several standards, and at the same time to have an energy efficient solution. I must say that for this part, I'm not the expert, okay? So I'll just tell you some vague information about this. For the reconfigurable part, so the idea is well known, is how to profit from dynamic spectrum XS, and in particular how to improve spectrum utilization using dynamic spectrum aggregation, and in this case we are focused on NCOFDM. So for the baseband processing we have basically been working on parts of the processing chain and to see how we can fit the configurability in that. So for the analog front end, this is mainly the work of Professor Michel da Silva and Kadam, and they have been working on the implementation of a Class G power amplifier because it has good efficiency and linearity, and trying to fulfill the functional requirements of flexible output power and operating frequency and energy efficiency. So this class of power amplifiers was proposed by CRIPS in 2006, and this is the current implementation. So this is one of, I think this is the demo that will be shown here. Okay, so the idea is that you have, you can tune the input matching network and the output matching network, the two vectors there. I think that this prototype does not have the pre-amplifier stage, but you'll be able to see how it works in the demo. Also, there are here some results. So basically here, what is shown is what happens when the output stage, the vector at the output stage is changes, when the supply to that vector changes, so when the capacitance at the output changes, and we can see that we can, in some cases, keep, for instance, in this last one, we have relatively constant output across several different loads and across a relatively large frequency range. In this, for instance, for the best in here in the lower right corner, we have a relatively stable gain up to more than 2 gigahertz and for a very wide range of loads. And work is going on designing a power sensor so that we can have information about how efficient the power amplifier is and can tune the matching to improve the efficiency if necessary. For the baseband processing, we have been working on a dynamically configurable infrastructure. So this is the standard chains, the transmitter and the receiver chain. And the challenges that we are trying to address is the ability to change modulation schemes, to change the size of the FFTs that are implemented, to have different synchronization and equalization procedures, since we'll have a non-static subcarrier allocation. We haven't done all the work yet. One thing that we are trying to change and really configure the hardware, so we have to have some idea about the time frames that are involved. That's one problem, to see if we can change the hardware fast enough for the systems. For instance, for this standard, we are talking about times around 2 seconds for moving or detecting another or initiation transition from one set of channels to another set of channels. So we need to have reconfigurable reconfiguration times for the hardware that are below this. The general approach is obviously to use an FPGA, which is naturally reconfigurable, and so that we can ensure appropriate throughput so that we can match the standards. We can have a flexible implementation. The power consumption is for reconfigurable systems an issue, okay? Because FPGAs typically have a large static power consumption, but in any way we'll try to improve on the efficiency, on the throughput, and also at least not possibly on the power consumption by using partial reconfiguration. That means we'll try to customize and have on the FPGA the circuits that are strictly necessary to perform the computations for the current mode, for the current standard, for the current mode of operation. So this obviously implies that we have problems partitioning the system. We have to account for the time to reconfigure. Power consumption can be a problem because the reconfiguration process also consumes power. And obviously the system in the end must fit all together. And we have several parts changing at the same time and have multiple possibilities for each module. You'll have to have some kind of management to ensure that system integrity is maintained. So this is the general architecture we are working on. This is the long-range vision. Okay? This is basically what Mario expects to have in 2 years or something like that. So we have a management unit, and then we have the NCO FDM engine, the implementation. Here we have already identified some potential models for reconfiguration, so the FFT, the modulation schemes, and the correlators for the synchronization and channel implementation. But we are right now. We started the work by looking at the FFTs, IIFFTs. FFTs. There's also one problem that we'll have to address, which is how to manage all the reconfiguration. Because we have to prefetch the configuration information. How do we keep that information? How do we avoid spending too much memory because there will be several modules. Some solutions are already available for different spacing configuration, partial reconfiguration are more or less standard, but there are other ways that we can try to make the reconfiguration work by adapting and manipulating the bitstream according to some parameters and adjusting from one bitstream, adjusting for different scenarios. Anyway, one of the scenarios, one of the works that was done was on the FFT, and that this is an architecture that allows, that has hardware that allows you to compute several sizes of FFTs, or even on the same hardware, a double stream FFT with two 64 point FFTs. So we can calculate FFTs for 64, 128, you see the numbers, including 1536 point FFT, which is not the power of two. This is a pipeline, so this is basically a Kulitaki mixed radix algorithm, 16 bits for the for real and 60 bits for the imaginary part. The order is natural. The system that we use to obtain some of the results can be seen on the right. So basically we have the reconfigurable process region, which is this bluish region there, and we can feed data through DMA controllers. So you can take the data. We basically are right now using data from memory, feeding it through the DMA, feeding it through the pipeline, and taking the results out of the story. On the other hand, above, we have the additional DMA controller, which is used to send the configurations to the configuration memory of the FPGA. Okay, so this is done from the external memory. So what? This is just a summary of the results. You can talk to Maru, who will be happy to explain, or to Amin, they'll be happy to explain what they have spent their time doing. Basically, this is for a Vertex 7 FFT running at 100 megahertz. The reconfiguration throughput is at 94% of the theoretical limit. That means we are not worried for this. System, things can get worse once we have the full chain, because it will be a more complicated system. The worst case time that we take to reconfigure, so to change between one of these configurations, note that here these configurations in the end here, the blue blocks means they are configured, okay? The white block is they are not used. But, for instance, if you look at the three last lines, they are not configured the same way. Okay, so the computations that are done on the blocks are different. Okay, all the blocks are used, but the computations are different. And basically, so we can run this at 100 megahertz, and this is enough for the, at least for the current generation standards. The worst time changing between one of those configurations is 2.3 milliseconds, which is well below the, or well within the 2 seconds margin that we have. Well, we cannot use the 2 seconds because other things have to be done during that 2 seconds, but this is 100th of the time. Besides the throughput, we do get some power consumption reductions because we are using specialized circuits. For instance, for the 2048 FFT, idle time is 1.28 watts average power. This is also basically the same for all the cases. It's typical of FPGA's behavior. But on the right column, you can see that the processing power, we can go from 1.39 watt to 1.55. So if you need just to do 164 point FFT, you just have to pay for 1.39 watt. If you want to do two FFTs at the same time, you have to pay more in terms of power. So you can, the differences are not very big, okay? But one of the questions is this power consumption? So we are, our main goal is flexibility, right? We are also taking advantage of that flexibility to, in some cases, reduce the power consumption. By only having active hardware for the FFT that is needed at a given time. The other question is that, say, for instance, if we change from 64-point FFT to a double-stream FFT, we save uh, 0.15 watts, something like that. The question is, does the reconfiguration cost more than that? Okay, and here we have the what was measured. These are samples taken from the actual board running, and when it's in idle mode, so it's spending 1.22 watts, which is relatively close to the idle average power that we measured. And when we reconfigure, then the reconfiguration time, the average power is only increased by 0.04 watt. And since the reconfiguration is very short, I think the power cost of the flexibility of the system is probably worthwhile. It's not big in comparison with the even relatively modest gains that we can obtain from choosing the appropriate FFT size. And bear in mind that we are having only one, we are talking about the reconfigurability of only one module in the chain, so we still have to see the impact of the reconfigurability on the other modules. So we expect this, we are hopeful that this will improve a bit. To conclude, we have one about the indicators on the part of the project. We have one ongoing PhD. So the first year has been of that PhD is complete, so it's now working full time. And we want to expect the PhD to start in 2016, which, if the project stops in 2 months, won't be here. We have some publications, mainly on the reconfigurable part, but also one publication on the high efficiency power amplifier. We have the prototype that we'll be able to see working. So we have, just to conclude, NESTEC contributed to tasks 1 and 4, basically. And our content studies and the reconfigurable NCFM processing engine. The dynamic partial reconfiguration has been shown to be viable for the core operation, this time FFT. So we were able to combine increased flexibility with better energy efficiency also. But bear in mind that energy efficiency with FPGAs is always something that is not as impressive as more custom designs. So for the front end, the class J mode of operation has proved to be a good solution. And we hope to achieve, which is able to adapt to large dynamic load variations with still a high power added efficiency. And obviously we'll continue to work on this in the future. Okay, so that's it. Thank you.
I'm Fernando Toledo. I'm from the Creation Project, also from the IT Covilhã team. I'll start by presenting the scenario I've been considering, but then I will do some specific presentation about recent work. This is, work is the work that we are going to present in one of the posters, but because we have been presenting other parts of work before in previous workshops and meetings of the project, I think it's important that we present here the new work in the result. This is a scenario with this pattern aggregation. Basically, here you have in blue and orange different frequency bands, and the scenario of carrier aggregation we have been considering, the manager, the common radio source manager, we named it the greater common radio source manager, in every TTI, every time interval, is deciding which frequency to use. So, by running some optimization algorithm, we proposed some algorithm. Recently, we have been using just a suitability function, so it's a metric, and each TTI, we are deciding which frequency band to use. We have been proceeding this for macro or micro cells, so here we have a use pattern tree, and then the other cells are yet to consider for the interference computation purposes. But now what we are doing and considering is small cells. So in the context of small cells, what we are now starting is the ongoing work to do is to consider carrier aggregation between the macro layer and the small cell layer. And in this work, we analyzed the case of pico cells. It's not indoor cells, it's outdoor pico cells. So in this presentation, I will first briefly introduce CAD aggregation and regression for analytical approach for modeling system capacity. We'll give an overview of the propagation model, cooperation or propagation models, we are considering different ones. And then we'll compare pico-cellular macro-cell layers, interference mass ratio, the carrier to mass plus interference, ratio, physical throughput from the analysis we are doing for the carrier to noise interference ratio, we are obtaining the physical throughput. And then the LT advanced system capacity through the analysis of given structural goods. So we are computing the contribution of the throughput from users at different distance from cell. And according to the distance the users are from the cell center, they will have different physical throughputs because of the modulation and code scheme they can get for communication. And we are having here a weighted sum of these contributions of different physical layers from different users at different distances. And this weighted sum will give an equivalent support. So the scenarios of carrier aggregation, basically you are considering interband carrier aggregation, where in two different cells there are different chunks of spectrum, and specifically we are considering non-contiguous parts of the spectrum. Okay. So this band 2, a given band, it is being aggregated with the same bandwidth in another frequency, band 1. This is a scenario that in the last 1-2 years was being carried out in the countries like South Korea, but recently in countries like Ireland or Germany, in Europe, now this is being introduced. And in fact, what happens is with in macro and micro cells with this aggregation, LT then can work because LT basically at near cell edge was having a lot of difficulties to operate because of problems of interference and lack of coverage. And basically, for instance, if you have the 2.6 GHz band and 800 MHz band, the lessons learned from the research and also from the operation, but I brought this to the previous meetings here, is that near the cell center we can use 2.6 GHz with very whose propagation characteristics are not ideal for cellular communication, but near the cell edge we can use 800 MHz. So this way, even the user closer to the cell edge are served and supported with the benefit of this much better propagation characteristics. So this is the rationale behind the segregation is to support the users near the cell edge with very high data rates. And but this can be decided every TTI for each user, which got some multiband schedule, so-called multiband schedule. So this is being decided, and the traffic is carried out either by one band or the other by running an optimization algorithm in real time. So this is the scenario Sofia Sousa was proposing, where macro cell operates in a lower frequency band, providing full coverage, and then small cells operate in a higher frequency band to improve throughput at hotspots. The other kind of segregation we supported, we addressed before, is to have two macro cells or two micro cells having segregation. Here in this scenario, what we are doing is to provide small cells, we can use a different frequency band, and in this cell we can use another this other frequency band, benefiting from the properties of one and the other band, and having the benefit of having much more capacity. This can be done in the past, beginning in 2009. We started by addressing aggregation by having one legacy frequency band and another shared frequency band, like the 5 GHz frequency band. So this can be used with shared frequency bands, okay? But in this work we are considering that both frequencies, the rights to use the frequency bands are bought by the operator, to the regulator. So this is the scenario I presented before. And basically, now the difference, we are either considering phantom cells with a different frequency band on top of this, but possibly we are also going to address to have carrier aggregation between two bands in the macro cell or micro cell layer, and then we have pico cells using another frequency band. So these are the kind of scenarios we can consider. And this is the novelty of this work. We are in initial phase, so here we try to characterize the interference and the impact of the interference in system capacity. Okay. So, for this, as in every cellular system, we try to characterize the carrier to noise transfer ratio. And in an LTA advanced multi-cell scenario, inter-cell interference is one of the main limiting factors for system performance with the frequency of deployment. And this interference is heavily in users at cell edge who may suffer from low connection quality. Here, a comprehensive study of the variation of the carrier to noise interference ratio with the different system parameters is performed. And basically, you are trying to understand what is the variation of NIR with the coverage and the use distance for the different modulation and condition schemes. And you have more than 20, almost 30 in LTE advanced. And for possible range of use patterns, this is what we have. And two heterogeneous networks at net cellular layers are considered. The macro cellular layer operated at 800 MHz, lower, longer coverage ranges justified to use the lower frequency band. And the pico cellular layer operating at 2.6 GHz. This is the scenario for this network. Here, what we are presenting is just the downlink pico rates for different bandwidths. But this is just for modulation, but for each modulation, there are different modulation control schemes. So this expands to a table with more than maybe around 27 or 28, 29 entries. But this is just a summary, a brief summary to understand that different bandwidths correspond to different downlink peak rates according to the emulation, but also then according to the coding, we can have much more differentiation between different levels of modulation and coding. In this work, differently from in previous works, where we considered the ATA models or other models, here we considered the IQR model, and which for the line of sight case, the IQR model considers two slopes. So the conditions of this work, we have for the macro urban scenario a change of slope and a change of the equation for the model at 128 meters, and for the micro peak urban scenario, this is for the peak in fact, at the distance of 156 meters, we have this change of pH. And L means the path loss. Okay, so basically, we have non-line of sight model, and in non-line of sight model, it's a two-slope model. And at 128 meters in macro urban scenario, there is a change of behavior, and in the peak of urban scenario, at 156 meters, there is a change of behavior. Of course, these distances are involved in the computation of the coverage. So, for a cell at a given distance, we have some behavior. But these distances are also involved in computation of the and this model in computation of the interference. So, for the frequency reduced proportion, when you compute the interface, we'll also have this two slope behavior. Okay? And this is something that we started to address, assuming that it's just another model, and maybe we'll get something from behavior. But in fact, we discovered that because of this two slope model characteristic, we are getting something very interesting in the result. This is formulation that I've been presenting this day also. The character noise difference needs to be higher than the character noise threshold, meaning character noise ratio. The character interference ratio is the co-channel reduced factor, RCC ratio governed by 6, and this RCC is the ratio between the reduced distance, D, the distance between the co-channel cell, D. Here we have plus R because the user is at the cell that's not in the center. So this RCC is the ratio between D and R. R is the cell range, and D is the fuse distance. Okay? And here is the equation. These are the equations that are in every test book. And the K, the use pattern K, is RCC raised to 2 to the right, 2 squared divided by 3. So this is obvious. But I presented it before also. So D is the square root of 3k times R. And by doing some manipulation of the equation, because we defined an M, which is the interference to noise ratio, it gives how much interference is higher than noise. But, defining this M, we can derive something that tells us the D over R, RCC, is the square with gamma as parameter of 6 times all of this equation. But when R goes to 0, we obtain this RCC, this limit, which means that this is the one horizontal asymptote. So we can do some asymptotic behavior analysis. And this, when M goes to 0, there is also behavior, and this gives the vertical asymptote. But in fact, what we obtain is this result m at 800 MHz, line of sight or non-line of sight. We see with non-line of sight, m with non-line of sight interference is lower than there. We reach values around maybe 60, 40, and here we reach values about 20, 30 in this zone of. But with that 800 MHz, we can go to distances, very long distance. Basically, this asymptote gives the maximum range we can obtain in the cell. Defined by this asymptote. This depends on the modulation coding schemes. Of course, for higher modulation and coding schemes, the distance are shorter, and for low modulation coding schemes, you can. This is why there is different modulation coding schemes in the advanced mobile communication systems in order to benefit from higher coverage from the lower modulation coding schemes. And this is for the 2.6 GHz, also line of sight on line of sight. We can see the two slope model condition in this equation. Need from the modulation problem. There is some difference in 156 meters, the change of behavior there. And as before, with non line of sight, we have lower end. Okay? And basically, what we are considering is the macro cell layer, orange, and the pico cell layer, green. And we are defining in the right-hand side D and R also for the pico cell layer. We are addressing two cellular systems overlaid, but two cellular systems, one pico cell and the other macro cell. And the CNIR, we have here for different frequency bands, we can see that for 2.6 GHz line of sight is low, much lower, or for 2.6 line of sight, it's also lower. So the and higher distances, shorter distances in this case, and longer distances, but it's for 2.6 GHz that the CNIR is lower, okay? And from all these analyses, what we have been doing is to study the correspondence of the coverage corresponds to some throughput, RB is the throughput, and we can map this CNIR level according to the distance inside the cell to the throughput, and we can do basically weighted sums considering that users are uniformly distributed, weighted sums to compute the average throughput. And this is information that we have been doing. Basically, there is this correspondence and this expansion correspondence between with CNIR, between these distances, the minimum CNIR, and also and then the throughput that can be supported. Okay, this is the implicit question we are being considered. And this is the correspondence between CNIR and throughput. So for given CNIR in a cell with a given R, here we are considering macro cells at 800 MHz with 3 kilometers, here pico cells with 300 meters, okay? So, but we can consider different arcs, but this is, and then we can see the variation of, for different bandwidths and different reuse patterns, variation, we have been analyzing this variation. And when we consider supported throughput, because of this two-slope model, what we learned here is something that is here in this orange or in this red curve. Normally there are some gaps of the 800 MHz or the 2.6 GHz frequency band. But when the two small models being considered, you can see that the throughput decreases, and then for higher distance it keeps like this. But because there is one zone where the model allows for less interference between one given distance and another distance of coverage. So basically, this distance is this one, the coverage, this associated coverage divided by the use pattern. between this distance we can obtain an optimum of coverage. So this indicates that we should, for instance, for 2 points, because we get line of sight or for the this is for different abuse patterns, 2 points we get line of sight. If we consider this in peak of cell, we have been analyzing the different assumptions, we can add the range of cells in this zone. Okay? Not longer cells, not shorter cells, but in this zone. So this is something that arises from the knowledge with the slope model. Okay? So this was basically the novelty of this work. Now we are applying these simulations to as a starting point to analyze practical results with a simulator. So after learning from this analytical work, we are now producing a model for the average queue, because we want to compare cells of different size in simulator, but we want to have the transmitter power that adapts to the cell size in order to save energy if cells are smaller and they have proper energy if cells are a little bit longer. After developing this model for the average queue, we are going to start the simulations to understand the behavior in terms of throughput in a practical scenario with this EPNET, PICO, and macrocellular layer working together, and then having different assumptions for one frequency, the other, for even maybe considering macrocellular layer aggregation and then aggregation again, supplementary aggregation in the with the pickle solar layer. So this is our goal for the next month. So, but basically these are the conclusions, but I think I addressed the main one. The lesson learned is that for small cell layer operating at 2 GHz, it operates at 2 GHz, owing to the behavior of the slow model in line of sight propagation conditions, where very close distance is it, a maximum occurrence for system capacity for power reasons are in the range between the breakpoint distance divided by RCC, I told the use pattern, the use pattern, and the breakpoint. So in this range, we have this special behavior with an optimum. This was what you learned by applying this IQR model to school. Thank you very much. This will be also presented in a poster together with other posters from Energy Arting and the demo, so we can discuss this during the poster session.
Great. Thank you very much. So we will continue with my presentation. Je vais vous dire
Eu tenho, só que eu tenho este cabo de é uma matriz ali da trás e os computadores que detectam automaticamente o videoprojetor não conseguem falar com o videoprojetor. É um problema de comunicação.
Thank you. Mas deve ser aqui.
Já vim na fase de
spend the full 20 minutes that were in the program. Okay, my name is José Vieira, I come from the IATA Institute, and we have to pass the hybrid to the bank, and start consensing as a step to perform some work on it. And okay, this is the summary, and I will move on. That is unexpected, the contribution on my radar. And so the IBA for the banks topic is something that we were already involved before the beginning of this project, and during the first 2 years of the project, 2013 and 14, we have been working. The idea of the IBA for the banks is to try to acquire a large bandwidth of the spectrum with a high dynamic range, because if you want to perform, for example, spectrum sensing in the presence of signals with the amplitude is very different, so you need a very high dynamic range, and usually if you use just one ADC, you have to adapt the gain of the amplifier to the signal with the highest power, and so you lose the small one on the quantization noise or on the background noise. So with the RF filter band, the idea is to have a filter bank at the front end with bandpass filters, and so you can adapt the gain of each amplifier to the signal that is present in each band. And so if you have in a band, you have a signal with a very strong power, and you have another band with a small one, because they follow different paths in the system, you can adapt the gain of the amplifiers and use the maximum available range of each ATC. So we have done some real experiments with I can say not so good results as could be expected. Actually, it's one of the tasks if this project has more 2 years is to characterize better the theoretical limits of this kind of approach. And we have several contributions, some papers that were published about this work. And so we have some ideas to move further using the knowledge of other programs. I can say that the main problem is that is we still have to face in the ADC, even with these higher filter banks, we have to face the jitter of the clock, and when the frequency of the signal to sample increase too much, the jitter of the clock would be a problem in performing that acquisition. So acquiring a huge bandwidth with a high dynamic range still is a very unsolved problem. Okay, so it is a very big challenge. Okay, in spectrum sensing, we were involved in this topic, and the spectrum sensing is also a very challenging topic because Well, first of all, is one of the key characteristics of cognitive radio. So cognitive radio is supported on this characteristic of a radio that can sense properly the spectrum that can be used or not. So only doing that properly, it will be possible to discover the opportunities to use the spectrum that is not being used. But the challenge is that you have to do detection with very low signal to noise ratio, sometimes below zero. And we have the hidden node problem, so sometimes it's very easy to find primary users and secondary users configuration that it's possible for the secondary users to sense the spectrum and not detect that the primary users are using it. And so provoke some kind of interference. And the other problem is that usually you want to perform fast detections over a wide bandwidth. So we come back to the first problem that, fast detections over a wide bandwidth, you need to acquire a huge bandwidth of the spectrum in real time, which is not very easy to achieve even with very high speed hardware. So for the spectrum sensing, if you go to the literature, you can find energy methods that are agnostic about the signal. So they just use the energy of the signal that they are measuring in each band. And then there are methods that try to improve the performance of the energy methods, but all of them need some a priori knowledge about the signal. So in our work, we focus on the first methods that only look at the energy of the signal. And there is also another problem, that is a frequency leakage in spectrum estimation. First appeared the multi-tapper method. It was one of the first proposed by Simon Aiken for the spectrum sensing for cognitive radio. And then we have the filter bank approach that we have implemented and performs a spectrum analysis with the control leakage. So it's one way to solve that problem. Of course, if you have enough resolution bits in your APC while applying the signal, which most of the time is not the case. Okay, but another problem is what we call the signal to noise ratio wall, because you can see over there for one channel, the energy method is very simple. You just square the signal and perform an average with L samples, and then we use a log scale in order to have a wide dynamic range for the detection and deal with signals within a very high dynamic range. And so the averages are those. So we have H0, which is only noise is present, and the other one is signal plus noise is present. And so you get these two, the signal E usually has a, you can follow a Gaussian model because it is due to the temporal limit theorem. So we have H0, which is the noise, and H1, which is the distribution of the signal plus noise. So it will be always at the right of the noise. So you can put the threshold in the middle, and you have a given probability of false alarm and probability of misdetection, as indicated there. And if one thing that you can do to increase the performance of this system is to, here we're using just an example, not a real one, it's an L equal to 10, but if you increase the L, for example, to 100, the variance of the estimator is reduced, and so you get narrow PDFs, and so you get better performance. And so one thing that you can do is to put this H1 and H0 closer in order to detect smaller signals within even a negative signal to noise ratio. But the problem is that when you have this kind of the problem is that we don't know the level of background noise. We have to estimate it, and usually we have small errors on these
estimation, and if you have errors on the estimation, you have errors on the where you put the threshold. And if you try to go to negative signal to noise ratios and put the H1 closer to H0, so you start to have a lot of errors on the probability of false alarm misdetection. And this is a problem that even if you increase here in the vertical line, you have the number of samples that you use to estimate your to perform the spectral sensing. And as you can see, you have these walls, vertical walls. It means that even if you increase the number of samples to millions of samples, you know, you don't have any increase in the performance. Okay, so this is a fundamental problem. There are many ways to try to circumvent this. One of them is not to use an absolute estimation of the background noise. Actually, get rid of that, and we only compare relative powers in different bands. Okay, so and you put a threshold comparing the power in the different bands. Another way is to try to, well, it's something similar that we do in for example, when you need to estimate the frequency of the carriage phase. Okay, you can do that because you have a lot of signals, and so you can average over maybe seconds. Okay, and get very precise estimation of the frequency of the carrier. And you can do similar things with the spectrum sensing. You use more data to get better estimates of the noise floor. So here, it's kind of we propose a different method to use more data and a automatic method to get better estimates of the background noise. Okay. So we have a recent work using the expected maximization algorithm. So we have here an example with four different signal powers. So we have the background noise and three transmitters. So this is just a simulation, and we have performed also some real data. So this is the signal coming from the background noise power, and otherwise are signal coming from different transmitters. So this is the output of the log estimated that I have shown before. So the model includes more than one transmitter. And so using the expectation maximization algorithm, using this Gaussian mixer model, we can figure out how many transmitters are in the transmit using the channel. And so it's possible to find their number, it's possible to estimate their relative power, and it's possible also to estimate when they are using the channel. So we can compare the channel position by each transmitter. And so we are working on this topic. We have several contributions already published. We have a paper on to a journal in preparation to submit this month. And finally, we have this unexpected result on bio radar that comes because of software-defined radio. It's very easy to implement a bio radar. So this is an architecture of the system, but basically it transmits a sinusoid continuously and receive the sinusoid, compare and detect the Doppler effect on that is caused on the sinusoid by the chest. Okay, so when you breathe, chest moves a little bit, and then we have the heart beat that is moved that has a smaller variation, but is possible to detect. Is a quite challenge and unsolved problem for signal processing guys, but we have the system here, so we have just use a software-defined radio board with two big antennas. And one of the techniques that we have applied, that it was some algorithms that we have already for using signal extractionary analysis, is possible to detect the heart rate and the breath rate. Okay, so using this technique, this is maybe it's one way to solve the problem of detecting the both rates. And we have published a simple paper about that, but maybe this is some work that we could follow in the next years. And so about future work on the future banks, further privatization and credit at all limits, and an idea is to explore the synchronization of online receivers, and maybe you can put them to work together, or exploring different bands, or exploring almost the same band, so that if you put them together, you can synchronize them and try to receive a larger signal with a bandwidth that is larger than each one of the Omadyne receivers could receive, could acquire. On the spectral sensing, I think that on the next 2 years, cooperative techniques and direction of arrival will be interesting to study and have some working models on that. On bioradar, we don't expect to work on that on the within this project, but so some of the open problems that we can work on is get better signals, in the sense that with better information about the Earth and grid rating, exploring multi-carrier systems, and also perform intelligent beamforming, because you know that to acquire those signals, you need to put antennas in front of your chest. So if you move a little bit, you lose completely the signal. So one way to make this more usable system is to have a kind of intelligent beamforming that maybe using cameras can detect the people and send the beam to the chest of the people to measure the breath and heart rate without any contact. And that's all. Thank you. Any questions? Okay.
Maybe about this expectation maximization based spectrum sensing. So you showed an example where one of the channel had only noise and the other channel had fairly strong signal. So how sensitive is the method if there are channels where the signal is below the noise floor?
Yeah, our idea is that you can use the expectation maximization algorithm to get better estimations of the background noise. So because you can detect when there is other signals present and when there is background noise, you can separate these signals from the background noise. So
does it work if the signal is, let's say, minus 5 dB below the noise?
It depends on the observation that you are using. Because if you increase the observation, those estimations become narrower and narrower, so it's possible to distinguish between them.
Do you avoid the noise wall?
Yes,
effect.
You can have a good estimation of the noise floor if the amount of time that the channel is not being used is large enough. Okay, so you don't need something near 50%. It can be something like 10 or 15%. If in 10 or 15% of the time the channel is not being used by any transmitter, you only have background noise. So the estimation of background noise that Gaussian always appear at the left of this histogram.
Okay.
And so if you have a lot of data, it's possible to get better and better estimates of the background noise. Okay.
General results of this project.
what I'm going to, or when I was preparing this presentation, I was thinking on how can I first present what is, from my point of view, creation, what we proposed to the National Science Foundation, the activities that we should do, and then I would show the results that we achieve mainly in IT Abel with our colleagues. So first, I will start with the problem. So what was the problem we were facing when we start to think on creation? And the problem was that we came mainly from hardware point of view of designing radio frequency transceivers, and the configurations that we had at that time were mainly super heterodynes or homodyne receivers, and we were struggling a lot to see how can we build this type of transceivers that are mainly analog based into a complete agile system. And for complete agile, what I want to say is that I don't want at the beginning to know what will be the local oscillator, because during the lifetime of my project, I can have a different local oscillator. I don't want to fix any filter. I don't want to fix any amplifier. I don't want to fix anything. So I want it to be completely adaptable in that sense. So we start to look to alternatives on the market. At that time, and as I will show you, fortunately, we break this, but at that time, these, let's say, most of the new radios, commercial radios, receivers, were based and are based on similar approaches like this. So you have an antenna, a bandpass filter, a low noise amplifier, and then you sample your system. Well, this was at that time, and I was talking about 4 years ago when we started to think on this, this was state of the art. But this was actually one of our goals. As you will see today in the demonstrators, with again the good team of PhD students that we had, one of the students break this, so now we don't even need the low noise amplifier, so I think it's the metrics are not as good as this one, but we are going in a good direction breaking this also. But at that time, that was actually our software-defined radio receiver, in the sense that what was fixed here is the bandpass filter at input, the LNA, but then it's sampling. So if you have a good sampling mechanism there, we are, everything that is here can be reprogrammed using an FPGA, and then it can be adaptable. And that was a first step in this direction. The problem is the filter in the input, and that's why we called Roberto in Alcalá and asked, oh, we have a problem with the filter, so can you help us with the filter? And actually, I think these international relationships were profitable in that direction. Well, but if you look from the other side, on the transceiver, on the transmitter side, was mainly based, and most of it based on upconversion, so traditional super heterodyne upconversion. But at that time, again, people were looking to something like this. So, curious systems, and this system was nice because you have a power amplifier here that you can saturate with a carrier, and then you modulate the bias of the power amplifier, and then you modulate your signal. And this was good for being, let's say, agile, because this is baseband material, so it's quite easy to implement. This is a class S modulator. It means that you can have a pulse width modulation or something in the input. And so this was a first step for agility, let's say. Well, again, with the good PhD students, we managed to bring we are now doing completely that and even better than that. That is, we have output of the FPGA, and you can still have the frequency, the bandwidth, whatever you want. The problem is the filter. That's why we need to convert again, because we need actually to filter the signal that goes to the air in order, but not to corrupt all the spectra, all the spectra in this sense. So these were, from a transceiver point of view, our main problems at that point. The other big problem at that point is energy. Why? Because from one side, all these systems are quite nice, but they spend a lot of energy, and they are very low efficient in terms of energy conversion. And this is mainly for the transceiver. So, okay, we can have lots of energy coming from other sources, but if you look to the mobile transceivers, that is the devices, we have a very big issue, and the big issue is battery. You need the battery to power it up. And the problem with the batteries, and this was already done within the project, the power with batteries is that we made, and Alirium made a very good study of this. And what is the power of batteries? Only for you to have an idea. In Portugal, we are a very small country, right? So we have 10 million people around that. And we assume that we have, and this comes from the national statistics, we have 4 million residences around that. 75% have a TV equipment, and we assume 40% have a TV box, probably more, and 30% has a sound system. And at that time, Alirio did a very simple calculation. Assume that you have a remote control and you have two batteries inside the remote control. And you have to change the batteries once or twice per year. So this goes, and if you do the calculations, to around 23.2 million batteries wasted in Portugal every year. And I'm not talking about the rest of the world. So, and where do the batteries go? Go to the garbage, of course. And this is a lot and a huge amount of pollution and a huge amount of money being wasted. And we should, from our point of view, that was also one of the proposals we had. How can we change this idea, or how can we reduce this battery problem? And thus, this brings me to what normally when I give some talks in workshops and in conferences, I always show this image. This image for me is creation and will be the future of creation. What is this image? From one side, you have the high bit rate. So you have the all digital radios, FPGA radios, so high speed radios, where you really need high data rate. Probably you have to cope with high power. FPGA doesn't work with low power. And they normally are high complexity. And here you have, of course, the mobile networks, you have the mobile phones. I will talk about this. And on the other side, you have the low bitrate situation. And the low bitrate, which when we start this project was something that we were talking about, now you have networks being deployed for bit per second communication. In Portugal, you have Sigfox, for instance. But there are others that are being developed. What is the objective? Is telemetry, mainly, and is Internet of Things, or Internet of Everything, or whatever you want to call it. So it's something that you can communicate with small devices, can get from their small amount of information, but what is the objective? Well, I don't want to spend the battery all over the place. That's why I showed the remote controls, I showed the metro card, and so on. So all these are systems like this. And this is why I put this in the middle, because the creation, from my point of view, will join these two worlds. And what is this world? Well, this is a washing machine, this is a piece of clothes. And what is why I put it here? Because ideally, in the future, what I would like is that my clothes is intelligent enough so that I can put the clothes inside the washing machine knows what type of clothes is there, and the washing machine cleans my clothes. I don't have to click on crazy buttons to understand what type, if it's white, red, blue. This is not for me, so I let this completely to the intelligence of the washing machine. But why I put it,
the washing machine should have access to a very high bit rate because there is a lot of information, different types of clothes, different brands, different colors. So the washing machine has to connect to a database, have a lot of transactions to decide what type of cleaning procedure or cleaning program I'm going to use. But from the other side, in order that the washing machine can identify the clothes should have a tag embedded. And I don't want to charge my clothes every night, so I don't need a battery there, so the clothes should have a tag that is completely passive, no battery at all. And this, of course, will move us to the 5G concept, and I will not spend a lot of time here, but the 5G concept will include, and hopefully will include, high bitrate simultaneously with low power, and high bitrate, low power, everything combined together. And this also brings us to the energy harvesting concepts or wireless power transmission concepts that we have. And this is why I say, and we have these challenges when we start this project, and we still have this challenge. From one side, I want a radio that is brain in the sense that it can take decisions for themselves, it can adapt, it can increase the bitrate, reduce the bitrate, increase the power, reduce the power, as he wants, let's say. But from one side, I want very single transistor or very single diode circuits that can actually power up these devices. So very simple devices that don't actually need the battery. This is, from my point of view, the main goal. We still have these challenges. So this, at that time, took us to the proposal of the creation project. And I pick up this from our objectives 3 years ago. The first objective was to resolve the bandwidth and dynamic range constraints. We hear today some of the results that other teams have achieved of that. And I think we are in a good line. I think we are going in a good direction, as you'll see. Then we decide also another objective was to build all digital transmitters and reduce of power consumption. As you see here today, we already have all digital transceivers, not transmitters, transceivers, which is even better. Dynamic reconfigured architectures with improved flexibility and efficiency. We hear here today also in ESTEC presenting some of these results. I think the flexibility is quite good. You'll hear in the afternoon also some of the demonstrators doing that. Reduction of energy spending using energy harvesting. Again, I will show you some of the results, and we have achieved some of this part. And design of optimized antenna infrastructure combining bandwidth and gain. And this is something that we are working on at this moment. Well, the work packages that we have at that time was, first one, analog radio front-end studies, energy harvesting, second one, antenna design, third one, reconfigurable and non-continuous OFDM processors for multimode spectral aggregation, flexible all-digital FPGA integrated transmitters for energy efficiency cognitive radio systems, hybrid filter banks, spectrum sensing, signal processing for hardware optimization, technical solutions and associated architectural aspects, and energy efficient optimization for spectral sharing and aggregation. The colors are the entities that are responsible for the task, and of course all the other colleagues contribute to different tasks in this aspect. Well, the project had a 5-year plan. We are here. Unfortunately, the FCT only gave us money until here, so now we have to request money for the last 2 years, and we have to see the results we had and what we are going, if we are going to maintain this proposal or if we are going to change some of the tests. And obviously, 3 years or 5 years is a long process in this area, so probably we are going to have to redesign a little bit the last 2 years of this project. And let me show what were the ITA bio contributions. So I don't have a very technical talk. I will show you mainly some slides. In the afternoon you can talk with PhD students around and you can have more information on that. And the third year results were from our point of view and IT point of view, what are the main breakthroughs we achieve? Well, I will have a slide individually for this one, for each of these ones. But the first one is D-parameters. The D-parameters is something that actually is a trademark of IT now, and will be the, for those that know something about radio frequency systems, will be the similar to scattering parameters, but applied to mixed signal instrumentation. And this is very important. Why? Because when you have an ADC and when you have a DAC and you are an RF engineer, you go to your simulator, you pick up an S parameter box, you pick up a generator, and then you want to put an ADC. And the problem is, there are no models for the ADC. How can I put an ADC in a true harmonic balance simulation and things like that? So we come up with a D parameter scheme. I can go one slide more so that you can see. And the D parameter is a new type of parameters. They are called D because of digital, but it can be also because of Diogo, because it was Diogo that worked on this, called the Diogo parameters, but not. It's digital parameters, and actually we do exactly the same as scattering parameters. This is the reflected wave, incident wave, so the analog port is exactly as a S11, but the digital port, we define a digital B2. So this is a digital microwave waveform in the digital domain, because previously we assumed that the ADC was only at the baseband. Now we assume the ADC is at RF, so the RF signal, which is a binary signal, is really an RF signal. So you can look to it as an RF signal rather than a piece of information, because then you have to demodulate your RF, your digital RF signal, and then you come with your digital information scheme. So the idea, what is the idea, is that you have an ADC, or we are expecting, and they are already in the market, you have chips that you have a small down converter and an ADC all together, so you cannot break them in two. So we can pick up this sheet, go to your lab, measure it. I have also here one of the example. We can go there, measure it with our box. The box that we have is from National Instruments. This project was the seed for a collaboration with National Instruments. Now we are collaborating with National Instruments directly in the United States, and Pedro Cruz, Diogo Ribeiro, André Prata is also now working with it. Arnaldo, of course, and me, we are supervising this work. But actually, National allow us to collaborate with them because they are very interested to have this black box. And what is the good of thing of the black box is that after you have the black box, you go to your simulator, you put the black box as an ADC, and then you can do exactly what you did with traditional RF blocks. And you can optimize, you can match the input of the ADC, you can do everything like an RF engineer, not like a digital guy that glues things to the RF part. So, we are putting a lot of effort here. This, as I said, this was a seed for the idea. We trademarked, we published in the Microwave Transactions last year. Actually, it comes out in October 2015, and now we have a roadmap with National Instruments to put this actually on the market, and hopefully this is going to be, I hope it's going to be a very good thing to collaborate. Well, all digital radios was something that was in our brain also when we think of this. And here, I will talk about this. And I took some of the images from the paper that we submit. I hope these are the last, but I think that there are already new results, I believe. But here, and in the afternoon, Arnaldo and the rest of PhD students, Daniel Linish, Rui Fiel, André Prata, will probably give more information about this. But for me, this is quite interesting, because actually, they were able to build the radio completely inside the FPGA. The only thing that you continue to have outside is the filter, And if you need power, you need a power amplifier, because the FPGA doesn't give you enough power probably to cover things. But this depends. Probably if you want to send information or signal, RF signal inside the room, you don't even need the power amplifier. The power that comes out of the FPGA probably is enough. And this, as you can see, is completely digital. What that means? It means that it's fully adjusted. You can do whatever you want. Well, and the good thing, and I think this is clearly a breakthrough in this area, is they have also built all digital receiver. Again, you have here a comparator, right? That they are like specialists here. Then you have here some, if you say a little bit of what you have here, but this is mainly building the FPGA.
This is a sample and not a solution.
Yeah. So, but this, what is important here is that it's fully implemented on the FPGA. The only thing we still need is the filter. Roberto is very happy with this. We need the filter all the time. And the LNA, of course. The LNA to reduce the noise. And of course, the LNA again depends on the environment you are. Probably in certain environments you can even allow the LNA to come out. But this is really interesting. And so they submit a paper recently to the transactions, which this image comes from there, where actually this is a fully all digital transceiver, where you see here the transmitting antenna, the receiving antenna, and all this is digital based on the FPGA. And actually, this, from my point of view, and as far as I know, is the first all-digital transceiver that I'm aware of. So we are waiting for the reviews of the transactions to see if there are any issue here, but I think it's quite interesting. And with that, they give a little bit, a step further, and they propose software-defined radio RFID readers and all digital RFID readers. Well, the software-defined radio RFID reader actually was mainly work of Alidium, and the objective there was mainly low-cost based on very simple equipment that you can find on the market. And it's already working. I don't know if Alidium bring the SDR to here. It's here.
I will try.
So you'll see it, and João did the all digital RFID reader. Of course, when I'm talking with people there, it's a team. This is mainly the guy that was in this specific project leading the area. And the all digital RFID reader, they were able to actually read, and in the case of João, I don't know if I have put it here. There are some images, yes, yes, it's here. So in the case of the all digital RFID reader, this is also submission for the transactions, they made a multi-band RFID reader. So it covers 30 megahertz, 800 megahertz, and 2.45 gigahertz. And the front end is quite easy. You need different antennas for each band. Then this is a wideband LNA, wideband PA, filtering, and then this is implemented completely in the FPGA. And they implement the protocol. What that means, it means that you use a commercial RFID on top of it, and it reads. So this was actually a very interesting problem that was actually resolved in this scenario. So if you go to the other side, that is the side of the energy harvesting reduction of batteries, what we have been doing? First, we have been waveforming design waveforms for wireless power transmission. And in this case, our objective was mainly to maximize the RF2DC efficiency in receivers. RF2DC converters that actually converts radio frequency energy into DC energy. And I will show you an image on this. Then we have been working on battery-less home utensils. I will talk, I have two slides about this. We have talked about, we have designed some smart floor concepts. And we have also start to design electrical coupling wireless power transmission and passive wireless sensors. So I have a slide for each one of those, but I will go there directly. Okay, first one is improved RF2DC efficiency using waveform design. This work was mainly done by Alirio Boaventura, and initially he will finish PhD this month, and recently we have also Daniel Bello working on this area. So what is the main objective here? The main objective is that we found that a diode, well, we didn't find this, I don't have the image here, sorry, but you are all electrical engineers. You have a diode, the diode has an exponential current voltage behavior, right? So if you excite the diode with a signal like that, or with a sinusoidal, this is what they were normally doing in wireless power transmission scenarios, what happens is that it goes to the diode, it cuts off of the sinusoid, so the DC goes up, and you have a DC out. So this is traditional when you do a rectifier for your transformer at home, this is the same concept. But what we thought, since this is a nonlinear device, if we are able to send peaks of voltage inside the diode, so we can go up in the curvature zone. And if we go up, then this DC goes up a little bit. And this is actually what we show. That is, when we play with signals that are summations of sinusoids, not single sinusoids, for the same average power at input, we get better improvement in terms of DC at output. So actually what we show is that we can extract more power from a diode playing with the waveform that we send inside the diode. And this seems like an academic thing, was quite important, so that we use this in a commercial RFID reader, Alirio did it, and we doubled the size of coverage we have with the tag. So with the same RFID reader, we put the multi-sign, and the tag was able to be read some meters away, more than it was before, because actually we were able to excite that. And then we built with the colleagues from Spain, so from Barcelona CTTC, we team up and we actually built a device that can increase the wireless power transmission range by playing with waveforms or sine waves in this sense. And these are some of the results, which are quite promising compared with the past ones. Well, the other thing, as I said, is that we then use this to change utensils at house, in the home. And the first thing that we start to look was to a remote control. And so again, and this is also the work from Alirio, what we proposed was to design a remote control that does not use a battery. So remove the batteries completely from the remote control. And this is what is represented here, and here are some of the prototypes. This is a prototype of our remote control, 3-button remote control, 5-button, 4-button remote control. So each of these prototypes, what they did is a very simple thing. They have an RFID that is switched or is short-circuited all the time. So if you use an RFID reader and if you illuminate one of these devices, you will not see nothing because they are short-circuited. When you click on the button, you open the circuit, and the tag is connected to the antenna, so you can read that number of the RFID, and if you read that number, then you can make a decision, go up in the volume, go down, you have a microcontroller that do these decisions. The hard part of this was actually to design the microwave network here, because we want to guarantee that when you click here, you have 50 ohm from there to there, and so on. So this was actually the hard part of designing this matching network for this test, this scenario. But at the end, we were able to go up and down MTV channels and actually use a remote control without a battery at all. Well, other things that we have been doing was to combine wireless power transmission, tags, RFID systems, sensors with alternative materials. One of the materials was cork, so So we try to embed these devices into Cork. Well, it's a good idea, it's an interesting idea. In the meantime, we discovered that the company will take this away from us, but that's life. But either way, what we found here, by characterizing clearly the Cork, is that we found, and it's more or less knowledgeable, but if you put water in the Cork, the permittivity of the Cork changes. So if the Cork is dried or if the Cork is humid, then the permittivity changes. And this work was from Ricardo Gonçalves, and if it changes, we made a humidity sensor based on Cork. That is, you have a resonator in the Cork that actually is connected to an oscillator, and if the humidity of the Cork changes, the resonator changes, the frequency changes, and you have a sensor for that. So these are things that were not thought when we start the project, but we could build it easily. The other thing is that by using these schemes, we also start to look to the floors. And why the floors? Because, again, teaming up with colleagues from Italy, we discovered that actually you can build antennas that can be embedded into the floor. And why is this important? Because if it's embedded in the floor, and the first project we had was to put a sensor in your shoe, that means that you walk around your house and you know where you are, because you are being identified by the floor if you have a large amount of sensors on the floor. So we team up with a group from a ceramic company in Aveiro, and we try to stack so that when you actually build your floor, the tech is already there, you don't need to do nothing. But this is only viable, of course, if the tech do not use a battery, because it wants to change the floor every time. So that means that the tech should be passive, and this is what we have been doing in the last time. And we have now a new idea that actually is going to allow, and this is going that direction, it's not here yet, but we are now combining, because here we were mainly using electromagnetic energy harvesting, but now we are combining a lot of other energy harvesters. So you can combine here thermal energy harvesting with this, you can combine sensor, piezoelectric material, so there is a huge new road, let's say, to go in that direction. And more recently, and this was with Ricardo Correa, and here what we tried to start working. We tried to start working on backscattering systems. Backscatter is what they use in RFID for decades, so it's not new. But we start to see if we can combine backscattering with wireless power transmission. And this is important because it allows our sensors to go a little bit further away. The traditional backscatter has 10 meter coverage. Combining with wireless power transmission, you can go probably to 20 meters or probably even further. And this, the first scheme that is being finalized is a sensor again, that actually, I don't know if you know how backscatter works, but backscatter is a new paradigm from my point of view of communication, because you don't really need a local oscillator. You only need the signal, RF signal that you send to the device, and when the device fills that signal, that is, you have an RF to DC converter, you have a DC, the DC connects the microcontroller, and the microcontroller starts to send the ID back. So, and how it sends the ID back, it normally has a switch, that switch your antenna on off, and then your signal starts to be modulated on the air. You sense this modulation, and you have an RFID because you have a code that is being modulated there. What we are trying to do is to code on that modulation information of humidity, temperature, and so on. This is good because you can have zero battery humidity sensors, temperature sensors, and so on. And this, as I said, we have been working mainly combining backscatter with wireless power transmission, and this goes to a dual band backscatter system. This was proposed and was published in the IMES, International Microwave Symposium, and now we have submitted a paper to the transactions. And we team up with a colleague, Shigeo Kawasaki, from the Japanese Aerospace Corporation, because they are interested in using these sensors inside ships. Why? Because the sensors inside chips, they need a cable for power. Even if they are wireless, they need to be powered up with a cable. And the amount of cable, the weight of the cables inside chips are huge. So the idea is that we can remove all these cables and the chip is going to be lightweight. So this is something that we are working on. This is a preliminary result. And now, with Ricardo again, what we are trying to do. Backscatter is traditional amplitude shift keying, so it has two stages only. So we already have first four stage, so four PSK, so it's a quadrature phase shift keying backscatter system, because we were able to generate four different impedances with our device, and now we are going for 16 QAM. Hopefully, the goal, as you will see, is to design a completely, fully passive wireless sensor network without battery, all backscatter based, and hopefully the base station is going to be an all digital base station, and the tags are going to be backscatter. Well, and in order to finalize what we have been doing these last 3 years, last but not least, so Ricardo Fernandes worked in a very important different aspect of powering up devices, and for, let's say, high power, near field, wireless power transmission, the most used technique is inductive coupling. So you have two inductors and you power it up. They are using this now for powering up electrical cars in the streets. So what we try, and mainly this comes from his mind, was why not to try electrical coupling? That is, instead of having two coils, why not to have two capacitors, two plates of the capacitor, and so we do transmission from one side to the other. So this is the sketch, this is the one of the first prototypes, and actually, in this case, what we showed, this is also published in, well, this is the wireless port division, it's publishing the transactions now also. So what we show is actually that if you have a resonant electrical coupling plate on each side, you can have similar results as inductive coupling, but with the added value that you don't need to have a very precise alignment between the coils, because you don't have coils, you have two plates of the capacitor. So this is also a very promising technique that is here. So I have three more slides. Feature vision from my point of view and from what we are doing in IT is actually to have, as I said, an all digital base station that can work with backscatter signals, and have a massive deployment of wireless sensor network that are completely passive, and probably have transmitter of energy around the area. So actually, you will have a base station inside the room, and you have sensors around the room that don't really need battery, mainly the sensors that are mobile, so you don't really need to have connection to it in that sense. Well, from what we propose also to the National Science Foundation 3 years ago, we propose two books, 20 journals, papers. We propose two national journal papers, 20 conferences, international conferences, 70 national conferences, 6 reports, 4 conferences, 12 PhD students, 16 masters, 2 models, I think, and 1 pilot installation, and 2 laboratory prototypes. I think among us, we already have all this. So only counting IT Armeiro results, we already have 2 books. So, and in both books, creation is there, so we don't have to have a problem with that. We achieved 14, the last number I have, in IT Armeiro, I'm not counting the other teams. We have achieved 14 transactions papers, so this is quite good. We have 21 international conference papers, and I think we managed to have all the results finalized as we were expecting in these 3 years. So let's hope for next year. Now we are going to hear about real things.
Oh.
Do you have to make a break or?
Actually, it depends. For me, anything is okay.
Okay, I think we don't have time to have a break.
Okay.
But I can get some cookies or move around. Yes, I know everybody.
Okay. Well, Roberto Gomez Garcia. So I can present Roberto. Roberto Gomez Garcia started work with us several years ago. He's a professor in Alcalá University in Madrid. He's also an associate editor for the Transactional Microarchitecture Techniques, associate editor for Surface and Systems, Transactional Surface and Systems 1, right? And he's also associate editor for IASMAP, right? Microwave Antennas and Propagation. He's, from my point of view, one of the most knowledgeable guy in RF. So hardware, RF filters, and he actually proposed a different technique that, from my point of view, changes completely the way how to design RF filters. And I think he will talk a little bit about it today. Moreover, let me also say that Roberto won recently the IEEE Outstanding Engineer Award that is given to persons that actually make a strong contribution in a specific field, and is a good friend of ours when you have other.
So thank you very much for your very kind introduction. So as Nuno has said, really it's a pleasure to be here. I was coming here by the first time in 2011 with the purpose of a collaboration with Professor Vieira and Professor Nuno Gors Carvalho in TAX project, and I think that was the precursor of this creation project, and we were working in a hybrid filter bank. So at the end, we make a good collaboration and we publish a good paper in the Transactions of Microbiology and Techniques. And now, of course, we are continuing the collaboration, and I really hope to keep it for a long time. So my name is Roberto Gomez Garcia, and I am an associate professor at the University of Alcalá at Madrid, Spain. And in this talk, I will present recent advances on multifunctional RF microwave passive components with static and reconfigurable single and multi-band operation. In fact, most of the results that I will present during this talk has been developed during the last 2 years in collaboration with two institutions in the United States, at Purdue University and the Naval Research Laboratory. So I think that I must acknowledge the collaborators that I have there for this development. So the outline that I will follow in this presentation, first I will start with an introduction in which I will try to show the motivation of the necessity of new filtering components with advanced performance. That means filtering components that can be integrated with other RF signal processing functions that leads to the so-called multifunction RF filtering components, but also we need even more fully adaptive filtering devices. Why? In the previous talks we have seen a little bit why, because next evolution is the development of wireless systems in which we are capable of handling different services. So for doing that we need filtering components that can adjust their response to the different standards that can be supported by these multifunctional systems. So, So after the introduction, I will present the solutions that we have proposed for multifunctional radio frequency filtering components and reconfigurable filtering devices. And I will finish with an outlook of the main advantage of these devices when compared to the state of the art. Well, we have seen that the current situation of the electromagnetic spectrum is that it's a resource that is very valuable and is being exploited by a big amount of service, of wireless service. So also, the new trend is the development of devices, for example, mobile terminals that are capable of supporting different standards. That means that we want systems that, for example, can handle 2G, 3G, LTA, 4G, the new 5G, etc. So we know we are in a scenario in which we want to have systems that are capable to support different services at the same system, at the same time. So the problem of this is that in the current solutions, if you take a look, for example, here we can see an example of an RF transceiver, multiband RF transceiver of Fujitsu. In systems in which we want to support different service, speaking in terms of filters, we need a big plurality of filters because each signal is different, is centered in a different frequency with different bandwidth. So we need filters with different spectrum characteristics in order to properly acquire the different signals corresponding to our system, to our service. So the problem of that is that as we increase the number of services to be supported by our system, we need a higher number of filters. And this is a problem because at the end, we can have very complex architectures due to the huge amount of filters that we could need. That means also increased power consumption, more cost, and some additional problems like, for example, more losses in the system because we need to connect our filters in such a way. So the purpose of the current trends is changing this kind of conventional architectures in which we use frequency static filters mostly by new and more flexible architectures in which we can replace all these filters with a single filtering device that is capable to adjust the transfer function to the different necessities of the system. This means, for example, a multiband behavior that is a filter with different bands. Each band needs to be tunable in terms of center frequency and bandwidth independently and so on. And this is not very easy to do because in conventional topologies, first of all, the development of multiband filters is something that was started a few years ago. And if we want to add to this kind of filter reconfiguration, it's not easy because in the conventional solutions, when we try to modify one band, we can affect the behavior of the other bands. So having multiband filters in which we can change or we can control each operational band in an independent way is not easy at all. And also it's good, and this is another trend that we can see in the last few years, combining the filtering function with other types of functionalities. For example, power division, amplification, and so on. Why? Because first, we can reduce the size of the overall devices, of the overall system, and this is something very important. And secondly, because by means of co-synthesizing the different functionalities of the device, we can obtain optimized performances. So this is in terms of the acquisitions of the bands that we want, but also it is true that due to this very saturated situation of the radio spectrum, there is another problem that we need to face up, that is the presence of interference. We are not alone when using the spectrum, and our system can be interfered by other interference and other services that are using the spectrum. For example, this is very typical in electromagnetic warfare or tactical communication scenarios in which we can receive jamming signals on purpose created by other systems that wants to deteriorate our behavior, our performance. But also, we can have, let's say, unintentional interference created, for example, for another wireless communication systems, base stations that are close to our system, but also
due to our own systems. If we think in duplex systems, we can have an interference in the receiver due to the transmitter. Okay? So this is another problem that we need to face up. So the traditional approach here, we can see an scenario in which we have a receiver that is receiving the signal of interest, but also some jamming signals. Well, if the jamming is in the out-of-band region of our band of interest, this is not a problem, because with the classic solution that consists in putting a bandpass filter, we can suppress properly the out-of-band signal. But what happens if in the band of interest, in addition to the signal of interest, we cannot reduce the bandwidth all we want due to quality factor limitations? So what happens if in the band of interest we also have some in-band interference? So we need to go to more advanced solutions in which we can create also in-band notches to suppress this kind of signal. So that means that we need at the end transfer functions that are more complex, that are capable of suppressing the out-of-band signals, but also the signals that we can have inside our band of interest. And this was a problem that was obvious with the development of the ultra-wideband communications standard, going from 3 giga to 10 giga. In this kind of system, we need to cover a very wide bandwidth, but it's normal to also receive in this very large bandwidth other kind of signals. So how can we do to properly acquire this broadband signal if we have also some in-band jammers without degrading the quality? So the solution is to create this kind of notches. So now I will present some solutions, first of all in the first block, about multifunctional filtering components with frequency static response, and in the second part about reconfigurable filtering components. So the purpose of this first part of the talk is to show how we can combine using a new philosophy for microwave filtering, that is the signal interference philosophy, how we can combine filtering devices with other type of radio frequency processing options. And we will apply this to different kind of devices, in particular to Wilkinson type power dividers that are devices that are very used in a lot of applications for power division and power combination functions, also to impedance transformation networks, and also to balance filters. Balance filters were very used mainly for integrated circuits, but now they are also becoming important in another kind of applications due to the most stringent demands imposed by new applications, which we need to suppress a lot of type of interference, noise, etc. And the advantage of this kind of multifunction devices is that we obtain more compact designs. If we combine in the same device, for example, the filtering and the power amplification, we can save some of the elements that we will need in a classic solution in which we will need to cascade monofunctional blocks. That means a filter connected to an amplifier. Also, we can optimize the performance of all the functions playing with the cosynthesis of the different elements. And of course, if we put together in the same device different functions, also we decrease the losses, because we don't need any longer the connection elements that we need in a conventional cascade arrangement to create or to incorporate several functionalities. So as I have said, usually microwave filters are designed by means of copper resonating networks, but this kind of networks has some problems. For example, they are difficult, or they are not very well suited for ultra-wideband applications. Now, some solutions have been reported about copper resonator filters for wideband applications. But at the beginning was not the best solution due to the limitation that we have to create a strong couplings in most of the technologies. And also, copper resonator filters that were very appropriate for single band components at the beginning were difficult to extrapolate to multiband filtering devices, as we need in current multi-standard wireless system. So this is why a new solution was proposed that was based on the so-called signal interference technique. So here I show one example of the most basic solution of a signal interference network, in which we can see that what we do is that we have two different signal propagation paths, and we combine at the output node the two signals once they have traveled by the two paths. So by doing that, we can create any kind of filtering transfer function. If we impose the creation of constructive interference between the two signals in the path in which we want to create the passband, we have transmission. But on the other side, if we impose destructive interference of signal energy suppression between the two signals, we can create transmission signals. So at the end, by means of this destructive, constructive signal interference philosophy between the signals in a multipath structure, we can generate a large variety of response. And the origin of this kind of filter was the digital filter techniques, in which we have in general multipath configuration. Well, some examples of conventional or not conventional, the first signal interference filter that was developed for planar microwave applications can be seen here. In the top part of the slide, we can see a dual band filter in which we can see that we have a very nice response with transmission signals and two bands very selective. And in the bottom of the slide, we can see an example of a low pass filter. This low pass filter, as we can see, have a very sharp cutoff slopes, and also we have a very extended stop band bandwidth. So these are two examples of microwave filtering device in planar technologies based in this kind of philosophy, in which we are not using copper resonators any longer. We use this kind of signal interference configuration to obtain performance that at the time of publication were much better than most of the state of the art. So what we have proposed is to apply this kind of cell to replace transmission lines that we have in other kind of devices to incorporate the filtering behavior to these devices. For example, the first example that I will show is how we can merge or how we can introduce the filtering behavior in a Wilkinson-type power divider. And here we can see the solution. The thing that we do is to replace, maybe some of you are familiar with a Wilkinson, what is a Wilkinson power divider. As you know, a Wilkinson power divider is basically composed by two transmission lines that are isolated by means of a resistor. But what we propose is to replace the transmission line by the signal interference cell. So if we do that, what we achieve is to put inside the Wilkinson divider also the filtering behavior. We can extrapolate the kind of filtering behavior that we have in a signal interference filter isolated into this device. So at the end, we come up with a dual function device in which we obtain at the same time the power division, power combination function, and also the filtering behavior. So here we can see one example of a four-band Wilkinson type power divider with 8-bit filtering capability. So we can see that indeed what we have at the end is a device in which this is an example for a 3 dB equal division between the two outputs. But we can see that in fact we can extrapolate this kind of philosophy to any kind of power division factor. But we can see here that indeed we are successful with this technique, because we come up with a device in which we have both the power division and also the multiband filtering behavior. With a classic approach in which we will try to design it by means of a classic power divider followed by the cascade of filtering components, we will have a larger size and also more losses. So it's a good technique. And another good thing of this kind of techniques, the signal interference approach, is that we can replace the transmission lines by the Lambic element equivalent. So that this is something that we cannot do in general with copper resonator solution, because how we can model a coupling with a Lambic element network? Maybe it can be done, but maybe not. But with this kind of solutions, we have a perfect equivalent between a transmission line and a Lambic element section, so that we can extrapolate this kind of philosophy to Lambic element components that can be integrated, maybe, and so on. And here we can see an example of a version of the previous device, but in this case for two bands. We can see that we have, again, the power division with a very nice filtering behavior, dual band filtering behavior, in which we have transmission zeros separating the two bands and so on. This is an example of how we can take benefit of this kind of dual function devices. For example, if in a more complex components like a balanced amplifier, in which if we replace the conventional power divider by means of this hybrid dual function filtering power division component, we can also incorporate in the balanced amplifier the filtering behavior. So here we can see how we obtain a device in which we have both the amplification and the filtering, the high selectivity filtering functionality. Well, another example in which we can apply this philosophy is impedance transformers. Impedance transformers are very essential circuit because at the end, they are, we could say that the hardware, the microwave interfaces between the different devices that we have in a receiver, in a transmitter chain. In general, we need to change the impedance levels between the different devices that we have, for example, in a receiver and in a transmitter. How we can do that? If the impedance are real, the most basic solution, depending on the bandwidth, is using the cascade of quarter wavelength transmission lines. So if we use the same philosophy and we replace the quarter wavelength transmission lines by this kind of signal interference filtering section, we can also incorporate the filtering behavior to matching networks. Here we can see one example of what we will be a three-section quarter wavelength transformer, but we have replaced the first and third stage by a signal interference network. So what we do is that in this example, we can incorporate also to the matching network between the two impedance that we have there, 50 ohms, for example, and 25 ohms, also the dual band filtering behavior. So again, we come up with a device that incorporates at the same time the filtering behavior and, in this case, the impedance matching network. And as a third example of this kind of philosophy of multifunctional frequency static devices based on signal interference techniques, we can also apply this kind of philosophy to the design of balanced or differential mode filters. That means filters that work in a proper way for differential mode signals, but for common mode signals create a rejection in the band of interest, because in general we're going to suppress the common mode. So here we can see one example of how we can apply this kind of philosophy to this kind of devices. What we can see that we have done is to introduce this signal interference section, transversal filtering sections, in a typical balanced circuit. So by doing that, we will obtain again a dual function device in which we have the differential mode transmission but also the filtering behavior for the differential mode. At the same time, we suppress the common mode. This kind of philosophy can be applied to multi-cascade design if we want to increase the selectivity of the filtering functionality. And here we can see one example of a device in which we have used this philosophy to create a balanced filter centered of 2 GHz. We can see in the top part the differential mode response. We can see that the differential mode response is the classical of a signal interference filter. Well, in this case, this response is improved, by the stack that we have for the differential mode. So the selectivity is even higher than the selectivity provided by a single signal interference. But we can see in the bottom part that if we represent the response for the common mode, that means when we have common mode excitation between the two input terminals, we have a big suppression in the frequency band of interest. So this is a device that behaves as a filter, suppressing the out-of-band signals that we don't want for the differential mode, but also for the common mode, we suppress the signal in the band of interest because we don't want to have common mode signals. Well, this is regarding multifunctional devices, but we have seen at the beginning that, of course, for the development of fully flexible transceiver, we need filtering components that are capable to adjust the frequency response to the different service that we want to capture. And in the past, several developments about tunable components have been developed, but the degree of tunability that we can achieve with the solutions proposed in the past is limited. So here we can see different scenarios that we can have. For example, if we have N bands corresponding to N service, and within each service we have different subbands. For example, we could need to acquire this band, but maybe this other band corresponding to the this other channel corresponding to the second band, or maybe we will need to acquire at the same time two channels corresponding to different bands. Or maybe all the channels corresponding to one band and suppress the other. What I want to illustrate with this is that in general we need filtering devices that are capable to adjust the frequency response, the transfer function, to very general situations. Because in some cases maybe we want different channels corresponding to different bands, we want to suppress another, etc. So the scenario that we could have is huge. More still, if we take into account that we can be, or our system can be receiving interference from other systems. So in that case, we also need to take care about the suppression of this out-of-band interference. So in general, we need very complicated, very complex tunable filtering components that allow us to obtain improved degrees of flexibility. So now I will present some state-of-the-art tunable or reconfigurable filtering devices in which I have been working on in the last 2 years with the collaborators I have explained at the beginning. So the first device is a device in which we can have at the same time a bandpass behavior and a bus-stop behavior, and in addition to it we can control all the characteristics of each mode. For example, in the bandpass case, the center frequency, the bandwidth, the out-of-band rejection levels, and so on. And in the bus-stop case, the same. And why is the reason that was so difficult at the beginning to create or to develop this kind of device? If we think in conventional solutions of bandpass filter and bus-stop filter, for example, if we want to make a coupled resonator, a conventional parallel line coupled resonator bandpass filter, the geometry is very different from that of a bandstop filter. That means that we cannot merge together, if we use conventional solutions, in the same device, the bandpass and the bandstop filter behavior. And the challenge is still higher if we want to create or we want to incorporate a fully reconfiguration in terms of all the figures of merits of this kind of device. For example, bandwidth, center frequency, and so on. So what we propose is using an alternative approach in which we don't use tunable copies. It's an approach in which what we use is tunable transmission zero cells. So here we can see the operation philosophy of this kind of circuit, in which the basic element that is in the red box is a cell in which we have two resonators coupled to a non-resonating node. So what we achieve by doing that is to create two transmission zeros that in the full device can be reconfigured by only changing the frequencies of the resonating nodes. So if we cascade several of these cells, at the end we can achieve a device in which we have several transmission zeros, and by only controlling the transmission zeros, we can change the center frequency, the bandwidth, the out-of-band rejection levels, and so on. And if we put the transmission zeros in the same position, we change from a bandpass to a bandstop behavior. So we have a device in which we have bandpass functionality, bus-stop functionality, and also we can reconfigure all. If we try to do that with conventional solutions, it's extremely difficult. So here, I saw an example of a development that was developed at Purdue University using a technology that they were, they pioneered there, that is based in substrate integrated cavity resonator. This technology is very suitable because in planar substrate allows to obtain a higher quality factor, that means lower losses. And also it's very easy to reconfigure. This can be done with conventional Barrett elements, but also with piezoelectric actuators that we can see there, that are like sheaths that we put on top of the resonators, and by changing that we can alter the resonant frequency of the resonator. So here we can see an example of a device composed of two cells, and we can see that indeed we obtain all the functionalities that we have illustrated. For example, we can see in one of the graphs frequency tuning, but for a bandpass behavior. Also, we can see in the second graph of the top part bandwidth tuning with transmission zero generations. Also, we can see that we can change only one side of the bandwidth. This is not possible to do with a classic coupled resonator configuration in which we change the couplings, because the coupling usually modify the two cutoff frequencies. And also, if we put the two transmission zeros of one of the cells allocated in the same position, we switch from a bandpass to a bandstop behavior. So this is the first demonstration of a tuner of filter components in which it's important to remark we are only changing the resonant frequencies, not the couplings. And this is very important from a technological point of view, because I can say you that creating variable couplings in very high frequencies is very difficult. So in this solution, we are capable of changing the bandwidth and all without using couplings, or coupling variations, sorry. Well, the second device that I will present is related with the necessity that I have explained of having a multiband reconfigurable device in which we can independently control each passband. With conventional solution, this was very difficult to do. Why? Because conventional frequency static multiband solution, what we do is to put the resonators between the source and load nodes, input and output axes. So if we do that, and we try to modify the resonant frequencies of the couplings of the configuration from one band, the other bands are affected, because in general, in configurations in which we put the resonators between the source and load, interacting between them, each band affects the other. That means that we cannot shape each band in an independent way. So a solution to overcome that is using the so-called quasi-bandpass approach, in which what we do is to put farther the resonating nodes from the direct path between the source and the load by means of no resonating nodes. So at the end, we can see that we have a configuration in which we are capable of creating a multiband response, but we avoid having interactions between the resonating nodes that are shaping path. And this is very useful because we can achieve the independent reconfiguration that was a problem with previous solution. We can configure the center frequency of each band without modifying the frequencies of the other band. And also, if we make variable the couplings that we have between the resonators and the non-resonating nodes, we can also control the bandwidth of the bands. It's important to remark that this is not the same than modifying the couplings between resonating nodes. That makes the configuration more sensitive. And another good thing of this solution is that can be extrapolated to any number of transmission bands. That this is another limitation of classic solution. If you go to the literature in the past 5 years, 6 years, you can find a lot of multiband filter for dual band response and for triple band response, but not for more bands. With this solution, even if I will demonstrate an example for two bands, but you can extrapolate for any number of bands. So here is an example of a device that was developed also in Purdue University in collaboration with the Naval Research Lab, of a dual band filter in which we have a full reconfiguration in terms of center frequency, bandwidth, and also we can obtain a switching of the bands by only the tuning the couplings. This is another advantage of this kind of solution. We don't need switchers to switch up some of the bands. Only by the tuning, the couplings and the resonant frequencies of the resonators, some resonators, we can pass from three bands to two bands to the bands we want. So this is another important advantage, because we save the use of switches. So here we can see an example that I call cangrejos because the shape is like a crab with beak, not with feet. So in which we can reconfigure all the things, center frequency, bandwidth, we can switch off some of the bands, we can merge the bands if we want, that this is very important because it allows us to obtain further degree of freedom in terms of reconfiguration. And here we can see that also another advantage is that we have transmission signals that are created in a natural way and that are reconfigured in a synchronous way with the center frequency of the band. So, to the best of my knowledge, at that moment this was the multiband filtering solution with the highest degree of independent tuning and also selectivity at the same time, because the transmission signals can also be reconfigured and can be extrapolated to any number of bands. This philosophy can also be applied to multiband stop filters. We have explained at the beginning about the necessity of suppressing interference that we can have in a system. So we can apply also this kind of solution to design not a multiband filter, but a multiband stop filter. So this is an example of what will be, let's say, the brother of the previous filter, but for a multiband stop response. We can see in this example that as we have illustrated in the graphs, we can obtain an independent tuning for each of the bands. In particular, this example corresponds, if I remember, fine to a three-band stop, a three-band example in which we can give, we can reconfigure independently the frequency. So in the top part, we can see how we can tune the center frequency, for example, of one of the bands without affecting the other ones. Also, we can see how we can also configure the bandwidth tuning for one of the stop bands without affecting the others, and also we can merge the bands. Merging the bands is very important because it's a way of having switchability of the number of active bands without using switches. If we put together the bands, the two bands or the three bands can become two or can become one. So this is another example of a device that have very nice reconfiguration levels, in this case for a multiband band stop response. And this is another example in which we can design a filter that allows us to obtain two functionalities and also reconfiguration. In this case, we can show, or we have shown, how we can put together a bandpass filter and also a tunable notch inside the bandpass. This can be very useful to suppress any bad interference that we have. If this interference is dynamic, it's changing the frequency depending on time. It's very useful to have a method to control, let's say, the frequency of the notch. So here we can see that what we have done is to incorporate in a conventional transversal signal interference cell, also a backstop cell in which we can tune the notch. So at the end, we obtain a response in which we have a very nice bandpass behavior, but also at the same time we incorporate a tunable notch. So this kind of circuit will be designed, for example, for an ultra-wideband system in which we want to suppress interference that can come in a dynamic way. And also we can apply this philosophy to design multifunctional devices in which we also have reconfiguration. Here we can see how we can do, for example, we can see how we can change the conventional solution consisting of using a filter bank of switchable filters cascade with a power divider by a new device in which we incorporate at the same time power division, multiband filtering behavior, and also reconfiguration for the bands. So this is an example of what will be the ideal response for a four-band synthesis example. And here we can see an example of a real device that we have developed for two bands. We can see that in this device, by incorporating the quasi-bandpass approach that we have explained, we are capable of having two independent frequency tunable bands, in which we can see in the top graphs we can change the center frequency of each band without altering the other one. We also have the power division. This is an example for a 3 dB power division. In the lower part, we can see that we can merge the two bands to create a single band that can be also reconfigured, and also the bands can be merged with a notch in between to create a bumper response with a notch. So this device that now is we have sent in a paper that is under revision also show a state-of-the-art performance we compare to other tunable multiband power dividers that have been proposed in the last 2-3 years. Well, and all these examples that we have shown correspond to planar technologies, but you know that there are another technologies that are very important. For example, in the wireless communication sector, acoustic devices are very important, acoustic filters. Why? Because they allow us to obtain a very high selectivity response. But the main problem of acoustic filters is that they are very difficult to tune. Let's say that this would be the holy grail, to have a tunable surface, a tunable acoustic wave filter, because they could change the philosophy a lot of transceivers. And this is something that when I was in US, people were very worried about that, because they want to change the philosophy of transceiver and receivers by introducing tunable acoustic wave devices. But there is not a solution to do that. And acoustic wave devices are very useful because in filters they allow us to obtain very high quality factors. That at the end means very high selectivity responses for very narrow applications with not very high losses. So we were working into that in Purdue University, and we came up with a hybrid solution in which if we add to a conventional surface acoustic wave resonator a variable capacitor in parallel, we can detune the series resonance of the acoustic wave device and the parallel resonance that we create to come up with a hybrid resonator in which we keep the high Q properties to create the passband, but at the same time we are capable to create two transmission zeros that we can tune if we modify the value of the capacitor that we have added. And this is very nice because allow us to obtain a response in which first, we can enlarge the bandwidth a little bit in relation to what is usually achievable with conventional acoustic wave devices. So we can extend the applicability of these kind of filters to wider band applications, of course wider band, but in the narrow band standards. But at the same time, we can have reconfiguration, and this is very important because we can come up with a device that is of high Q, and at the same time we can modify the behavior. So this is an example of an architecture that we propose for doing that. We can see that it's related with the previous architecture that I have shown, in which we are coupling the resonators to the main transmission line by means of non-resonating nodes and inverters. So here we can see an example of a lumpic element prototype in which we have combined surface acoustic wave resonator with a lumpic element prototype, with lumpic elements. Some of them are variable in order to achieve or to obtain this kind of reconfiguration. And we can see that we obtain what we want. By means of this hybrid solution, we are capable of having a filtering device in which we keep the very high quality factor of acoustic devices, but at the same time, we are adding reconfiguration, in this case, reconfiguration of bandwidth. To the best of our knowledge, this was the first demonstration of a tunable acoustic wave bandpass filter that at the same time allows to enlarge the applicability of these kind of devices to wider applications. And also we can apply this kind of technique to design absorptive bandstop filters. Absorptive bandstop filters are a specific type of bandstop filters in which the energy that we don't want to pass is not reflected, it's absorbed by the filter. Okay? And this is very important because it prevents other blocks that we can have in the receiver and the transmitter chain to be interfered by the filtering block, because there are no power deflections. So we apply also this kind of hybrid resonator, acoustic wave lumpic element resonator, to create a device in which we can, for a bandstop filter in this case, reconfigure the bandwidth, but also the rejection level that we achieve. We do that by putting in this configuration tunable resistors. So by putting tunable resistors, we can change also the attenuation levels of the top. So at the end, we come up with a device in which we have bandwidth reconfiguration for an acoustic device, but at the end, at the same time, we have also isolation level reconfiguration that is very important, for example, as a spectrum equalizer. If we replace these resistors by elements that are sensitive to the power level of the incoming signal, we will come up with a device that can be adjust the rejection behavior to the level of the power signal. So this is also a multifunctional device in which we have very nice reconfiguration properties for our acoustic monitors. So to conclude my talk, we have present several examples of this is multifunctional filtering components and reconfigurable filtering components that are very important for new or emerging wireless applications that are coming in the future. We need more adaptive transceivers, so we need circuits that are capable of performing more flexible functionalities. So regarding multifunctional circuits, we have seen using the signal interference philosophy how we can combine the filtering behavior with other kinds of RF processing actions. And also we have seen several examples of state-of-the-art reconfigurable filtering components in which we have presented a device with a tunable transfer function. Also we have seen how we can design multiband filters in which we can reconfigure in an independent way center frequency bandwidth and so on by using a new philosophy that is the quasi-bandpass philosophy. How we can extrapolate also this philosophy to multifunctional reconfigurable components. And also we have seen how this kind of philosophy can also be extrapolated to other technologies like acoustic wave that are very important in the wireless technology market, because these kind of devices can be found in a lot of mobile applications and so on, even in space applications now for the intermediate frequency stage. Acoustic devices are taking a big importance. So we have shown how we can also, by hybridizing this kind of technology with lambda element and other kind of variable reconfigurable elements, we can come up with devices that keep the good high quality factor of acoustic wave resonator, but at the same time incorporate frequency reconfiguration. So this concludes my talks. I think that maybe I put a lot of devices, but I wanted you to show different solutions. Which filter?
For instance, in the one that you use a piezoelectric.
Okay, yeah. In this case, it's like, for example, it's, this is based on a cavity resonator. So, what you do is that a cavity resonator, usually you have a post, okay, and then the cavity. But the piezo is something that, depending on the voltage that you apply, moves a little bit.
Yes.
So, this suppose at the end, or this gives you the equivalent behavior of a variable capacitor that is loading the cavity. So at the end you have a resonator in which, by modifying the biasing of the piezo, you are moving the piezo, so you change the resonator.
You really change the characteristic.
Yeah, for sure.
Physical characteristics.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. It's a deflection, it's a small deflection of micrometers, something like that.
And on the saw?
No, on the saw, no. On the saw, in fact, in this case, I think that in this case, we use trimmer capacitors. Because we did two versions. One of them with trimmer capacitors and the other one with paratons. Okay. I think that this one is the, I think that is the trimmer capacitor one. Okay. So you change these elements.
The differential filters that you have shown, you have shown filters, differentials to differential. Would it be possible to have differential between the Lambert filters?
Okay. So you mean that, yeah, this filter is differential to differential.
Yeah.
So you, what you mean, I think, is a volume filter will be.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah, this can be applied also. Let's say that the good thing of the signal interference philosophy is that as long as you have transmission lines in a configuration and you don't use couplings, you can replace the transmission line by this kind of signal interference cell, and you can add to the classic behavior, to the intrinsic behavior of this device, also the filtering functionality. So of course, you can apply this philosophy to balloon filters.
Okay, so thank you. Any questions more? No. So thank you again to me. Próximo, vamos tentar falar um bocadinho no. Nós vamos abordar mais de uma hora. Se calhar começar às 2h30 vai ser um pouco apertado, vamos começar a conversa do professor Carlos, vamos às 3. O almoço é livre, existe aqui perto ao snack aqui da universidade, com o restaurante. Há outros restaurantes à volta, mas o mais perto e mais rápido é ao snack, ao restaurante da universidade. Podem deixar as coisas aqui dentro, que se, não sei se alguém quer ficar cá dentro a fazer alguma coisa. Se ninguém quiser ficar, eu durante este tempo vou pedir ao segurança para fechar a porta e portanto vocês podem deixar tudo o que quiserem, portanto fica fechada a chave. Ok, então até já. Ah, meu Deus.